It's my deep pleasure to introduce Lieutenant Colonel Nikki Dean, a dear friend of mine who served for 20, who has and is continuing to serve, excuse me, for 21 years of active duty in the United States Army. She is deployed to Iraq and Afghanistan numerous times. Now, by trade, she is an attack helicopter pilot. Currently, she is an Army doctrine writer, and this is her second go-around on that field. Now, we won't hold this against her here in Kansas City, but she is originally from Buffalo, New York. She's very emotionally conflicted every time the Chiefs and Bills play each other. Hopefully, we can continue to bring her over to the light side of the force, but we don't hold anything against our Bills fans. She does have a bunch of degrees, and I would list them here, but she says that her degrees make her extremely marketable to the Army nerd crowd. So do with that as you will. She has been stationed around the country as well as in Germany and Korea. And congratulations to her. At the end of this year, she is retiring from the United States Army. Folks, please join me in welcoming Lieutenant Colonel Nikki Dean.
Well, thank you so much for the kind words. It's really greatly appreciated. And for somebody who's been involved or has participated in some of these presentations as the audience, it's really daunting actually to be on this side of the screen presenting material. So I was super excited the minute that James said that he wanted to bring somebody on to talk about specifically the role of Army doctrine, the role of language, and how we can use a metaphor like counted cross stitch and needle art to explain and to show that there's a way for us to bridge the gap between the experiences of a layperson and the experiences of the military with the language that we have. So thank you so much for welcoming. I'm gonna share my screen so that way everybody has a chance to see this. And I'm sorry right off the bat, two things. If I fumble around a little bit with the technology side of it, like I said, it is daunting to be on the side of the screen. And then also along with it, there is a dog. She's moving in the background. I'm sorry if she's distracting. Should have probably figured this out after 2 years of doing these sorts of things with the pandemic. So without further ado. And can everyone see?
Looks great to me.
All right. Wonderful. Well, again, as James said, my name is Lieutenant Colonel Nikki Dean. I am currently a doctrine writer with the U.S. Army's Combined Arms Doctrine Directorate up in just north of Kansas City, in a place called Fort Leavenworth. It's been a historic fort, but it also is the home of the way that we evolve and the way that we manage the body of knowledge for the U.S. Army. So an opportunity like this to talk about how U.S. Army doctrine can be useful to a layperson, but also to a certain extent to talk about how we can use different metaphors, specifically embroidery arts, is a terrific opportunity, I think, to bridge a civil-mil divide that has always existed, but also to share something that I feel very, very passionately about, which is the Army's body of knowledge throughout history. So I will say that there's always a problem statement. This is something that the United States military has had for a long time, which is this idea of we use operations to solve problems, and typically they're military problems. So when I began to look at this idea of what is military doctrine, and also what are these different things that I do personally as an embroidery artist or as an embroiderer and a cross stitcher, I began to question about, has there always been this language of military operations that's been exclusive in both positive and in less positive or unconstructive ways? And was there a gap to bring things together to help us talk about ourselves as the military within the community of arms and also outside of the community of arms, which sometimes we tend to be jingoistic and we tend to be niche in ways that sort of isolate and alienate people who would like to use the military's language appropriately and also just want to understand what some of these terms that are being thrown out, what they mean. The military, I will say right off the bat, because we are a large bureaucracy, we can make a bureaucracy out of anything. And I swear sometimes that bureaucracy translates over into these texts or into this body of knowledge, which can be frustrating to read through and even at times boring. And overwhelmingly, that sometimes becomes risky or challenging to overcome. But I think that there is a great opportunity to talk about this. More importantly, the way to discuss military language, it opens up this arena for me to be able to talk to everybody here about what is Army doctrine, what it means to have a language and have a body of knowledge. It's also to talk about why doctrine has existed and to help others find out ways to use it, much the same way that I guide soldiers on how to use doctrine, how to use the Army's body of knowledge, and to make it fun by using this nifty, neat little metaphor of counted cross stitch. So as military professionals, straight off the bat, I will admit that we also tend to have, I want to have a thesis as well on this. There are always metaphors that we can use. There are also things that we do in planning that kind of help us with shaping how we're going to approach things. And it's always these things called assumptions and facts, those universal truths, and then also assumptions that are sort of informed by universal truth and universal fact in history. So when I began to kind of put together this thesis of could you bring the language of war and the language of embroidery together at the same time, I walked into this with this assumption that, first of all, the language of war has to be, and warfare itself needs to be, this relatively stable thing, that it hadn't changed over a period of time. And surprisingly enough, the more I looked back at it as both a doctrine writer, but also as somebody who's been in the Army for 20 years, it seems like, yeah, you know, the assumption that the language has remained the same was pretty solid. It was one that I was willing to, it's a hill I'm willing to plant a flag on. And along with it, when I looked at it from the perspective of embroidery and cross stitch, the language of needlework, surprisingly enough, is cross stitch is the oldest form of embroidery. It remained the same too. So I was like, okay, cool. That assumption works for here. This assumption also works for this metaphor I wanted to use as a lifelong stitcher. Along with it, I began to wonder if the assumption could be safely made that technology changes. And we get new weapon systems on the battlefield. We get new methods out there to be able to employ these various formations, various techniques. But can the principles still remain the same? And I think most historians would say, yeah, of course, the principles of war and warfare have remained largely the same. And they echo, especially the Western way of war that we see as enthusiasts for this museum and other museums, that seems to be pretty stable too. We can say that there are principles, and there are also principles that guide hand embroidery, hand cross stitch, even with the advent of new technologies like machine embroidery, like, you know, new tools like digitized patterns and so forth. So knowing that a profession and a hobby could share certain truths, I kind of began this idea of, could I use these two things to compare and talk to lay people about military doctrine? And the reason why it's so important is because there are some universal things that we all do all together when we talk about a new craft or a new hobby, and also a new profession or how we talk about the profession in total. We all of us, we develop new skills, but we have to start somewhere. It doesn't matter the trope and the silliness of joking about a young lieutenant who's kind of a novice or is wet behind the ears, that there's always a new starting point for everything. And also, if you're somebody who's done cross stitch or done embroidery for a while, you kind of know that as well. It all looks a bit of a shambles or a bit of a mess when you first start out any place, but to develop it, a new skill or a new talent, you've got to start with a baseline of knowledge. And usually for most of us, it comes with an oral tradition that is passed down, but also to a certain extent, there is an existing body of knowledge that's out there, even for embroidery. also along with it to be able to share that common knowledge, which, you know, I think some, if you wanted to use the really nerdy term, the epistemology, right? This, to share a common knowledge requires you kind of have this common lexicon and common language. We all kind of need to know that that word means that thing, and it should remain relatively stable so we can all talk about it the same way, and we can begin to evolve our skills and evolve our knowledge and experiment with new language and new techniques. Every new skill, anything that you do for the first time, as I said, it's always a bit of a shambles, but all new skills have to have a baseline from where to start. For the US Army, it's that we codify that baseline to help so we're not reinventing a wheel every single time we go into combat. Every time we go into armed conflict, shouldn't be a new chance to rethink something. It's the same way with, and as I found throughout the years, it's the same way with embroidery and with cross stitch. Those things remained relatively the same, and all new skills began with a baseline of techniques. The way that we describe these various genres, I felt pretty safe in saying and coming to you guys and presenting the idea that, hey, the way that I talk about all this doctrine stuff, it's pretty much the same as embroidery and cross stitch, which I'm going to plant my flag on that hill and now prepare to defend it against everybody here. So it helps, as we said before, to kind of have a background. So if you've never been exposed to the Army before, here is how to think about doctrine. When we talk about doctrine as a thing, it is fundamental principles. It is the supporting tactics and techniques and procedures, and also terms and symbols that come along with it that help us communicate how we do or how we conduct operations. It's the guide. It's the guide for how we operate as a force altogether. And this is, like I said, this is the US Army. So when we talk about that, we're talking about an institutional force that, hey, this is what we do. This is what we do as a community together. And oddly enough, when I began to look at cross stitch as a form of needle art, when I looked at the definition in Merriam-Webster, that form of counted cross stitch and thread embroidery, like, it surprisingly, that definition remained largely the same. So I think we can go forward with these things saying, yeah, you know, these are stable definitions. These are stable understandings of how it's worked, or how these bodies of knowledge have worked, and how this thing that we do works. Most notable about the language of anything, whether it's Army operations or cross stitch, what really I think is kind of cool to note is that we all of us, cross stitchers and Army people alike, we love to stratify our techniques, and we love to kind of categorize, bin stuff in places. And it's that taxonomy, or that ability to build something, it makes it really nice because we can categorize everything. And I will say this in the Army, we love to categorize stuff. Categorizing and building models and putting things in neat little bins, it helps, especially when you're dealing with something that is such a complex idea as war and warfare. Oddly enough, it seems like cross stitch, when I've kind of dug, you know, you go out and you Google, or you wander down the floss tube portions of YouTube, you're like, oh, yeah, we do that too. Cross stitchers have a tendency to just sort of, they all want to categorize and bin folks or bin certain methodologies much the same way. So I was like, oh, I feel comfortable in wandering around in this, in both of those worlds. Along with it, there is a specific language that we use to organize our techniques, and that's called a lexicon. That lexicon is we use one for the Army. It sounds really boring at times, and I apologize for that. But we also have one for cross stitchers and embroidery people too, where you're just like, it's back stitch, it's cross stitch, it's quarter stitch, it's French knot. And all these things, this lexicon means stuff to us. Sometimes it doesn't mean anything to anybody else, but there is a place where we've dumped that, and we can all say it together like those words sound familiar to me, or those words sound familiar to the group of folks who come together to stitch. I would imagine, though I'm not one to knit, and when I crochet, as my best friend will tell me, who she was the one that taught me, I am a terrible crocheter. I make misshapen scarves, and that's about the extent of my skills. But when I've watched her, when I've talked with her about her experiences, both as a crocheter and also with friends who knit, it's much the same way, that there is a language of how to do certain things, and those things always tend to mean the same words over time. what ends up happening out of all of these things, and I'll close this little portion of defining stuff out, is we tend to get these pedantic acolytes who must insist on very specific things. That becomes, and I will fully admit it, that becomes almost negative to having a deeper and better discussion, both on the side of the Army's use of language and the Army's use of terms and professional soldiers using terms, and as well for people who are starting out in the world of cross-stitch and embroidery. You get these pedantic acolytes who are like, you're using the wrong word. That's not the right word. This term is wrong. That's not what you should be using. And the problem is that that shuts down meaningful discussion and meaningful growth. And also it almost sort of alienates novices or people who have a mild and passing interest in trying something new, which includes people who are amateur military historians, folks who just want to exist in a world of museums, who want to consume, even to a certain extent, pop military history, you know, movies and other things out there, books and novels that still have military terms, and they want to ask questions, but you get that one person who won't come off the definition of a term. We jokingly call it in the doctrine writing community, you know, we tend to get into the weeds and we become angels dancing on the head of a pin. And that's not helpful sometimes. So I would like to throw that out there for the group. When it comes down to history, where I found the most joy, or where I found this kind of aha moment of looking back at the history of both the work I do in this assignment and also the history of this hobby that I've had for actually close to 30 years, what I ended up finding was the sampler, the idea of a sampler. And if you're somebody who does embroidery, you're very comfortable with the idea that a sampler is this thing where we capture an image so that we can refine a technique later on. Doctrine is much the same way. That was a revelation to me when I began digging into it, that the process of codifying techniques resembled an embroidery or a cross-stitch sampler very, very closely. And there's a history of doing it. So we have this incredible institutional belief system that has started really back in 1607. It was the first time that you see this book, which was for German Western European methodology on employing musketeers, arquebuses, and pikemen on the battlefield. And it was a very tactical or very technique-oriented book, almost technology-focused in a way, because it was focusing on how to employ pikemen on a battlefield, which when you think about it, that is something that you know, if you've never had a pike before in your hands, you probably would like to know, what should I do with this aside from just stabbing somebody with it? Seems pretty logical. Along with it, like, there is this history that comes along with it that sort of stays, I'd say, in the 1700s through to the 1800s of a very technique and very technology-oriented doctrine. So that way you know how to employ the things that you have at your disposal. To include our own history as the U.S. Army. The U.S. Army in 1779, under the auspices and guidance of Major General George Washington, even prior to that, worked with a young author and a young military professional and theorist, Baron von Steuben, and produced what became known as the Manual for Order and Discipline of Troops, of American troops in the U.S. Army. And really what that was is our first doctrinal manual on drill and ceremony that was being used to employ forces on the battlefields in an organized and ordered kind of way. And that right there is really where you see for the first time in the United States military, this idea that techniques kind of get organized in a way, written down in a book, approved by an institutional belief system, and boom, we can all sit and have the same language and talk the same way about how we're gonna get our colonial troops to do certain operations or certain tactics on the battlefield. Flash forward, because this is the World War I Museum, flash forward to about 1905, and this new book of tactics begins to, or this new codification method of tactics comes out, and it's the field service regulations. And these field service regulations kind of remain relatively stable all the way through to really post-World War II era. And this is tactically focused. It's the same sort of thing where we see, what does it mean to do a raid? What does it mean to clear a bunker? All of these, even to a certain extent, really, what does it mean to sustain a force? And this tiny little grouping of books, these field service regulations, guide our US Army through World War I and its employment, and also through World War II. And ultimately, the lessons that are learned and captured evolve within the book and evolve within those books. And that whole methodology of what we're doing, of tactically focused, of very unit focused methodologies, kind of stays the same for a long time. The language stays stable, the definitions stay stable. But what I will say is, come around to about the 1970s, in the, let's say, the post-atomic, but also about the era that's coming around to post-Vietnam. And we start to change as the US Army, the way that we look at doctrine. And we get this new operationally focused capstone manuals. And these books, despite the fact that they are attempting to wrestle with the best bad idea at a moment in time with the force in being, what was most clear, what has remained most clear, is that still the terms that we use, the definitions that we use, the words that we use, those are still relatively stable in time. So even looking all the way back, an attack is still an attack. A defense is still a defense. Offense is still offense. These things may have evolved a little bit to mean something new, but the words are the same. So it's illuminating in that regard, because doctrine really did, to me, I began to realize that if the language remains the same, we can capture and add things, and we can talk about stuff with amateur historians, with professional historians as well, but also with a greater audience saying, hey, no, the word attack means the same thing. I want you to know this word as well. So that way, when we talk about something, we're talking about something without euphemism. What was most illuminating, like I said, of the sampler technique idea is samplers, and the idea and the evolution of embroidery kind of almost in a way follows the same trajectory, to the point where we see, though it's much earlier, Coptic Egyptians actually kind of began the method of sampling, or of sort of capturing a stitch or a moment in time with stitches, 400 to 500 CE. But the idea of taking down an image, or taking down and sampling an image and then growing the image, it ends up beginning in the late 1500s, and then keeps moving straight on through. It was illuminating to see that there has always been this tradition in history. So it's natural to say US Army doctrine is a sampler. I will also say one more thing about doctrine, which is, and this is something as people kind of read through it, what they've noticed is that the books get bigger, the definitions get longer, we get more for a while, especially in the 1980s, we get a lot of, we just love to write things down, but we have a tendency to not delete things. So really the sampler, the idea of a traditional sampler, this person who would make a stitch, put it onto a piece of fabric, and then keep that fabric growing as they refine their stitching skills, or as they saw something new. It really was a terrific metaphor for how we do doctrine, because I will admit to you, Army doctrine is hoarding. We have a tendency to hoard techniques into a book and write them all down. And then we'll go through this massive purging effort in which we'll cast something aside, and then we start the hoarding process all over again. I feel very comfortable. I will stand on that hill and defend it, partly because we have that pattern. We have that pattern as doctrine writers. So when I began to look at the fact that certain things remain stable, what I really found, or certain words remain stable in doctrine, what I really found was, could I use the language of doctrine, the language of army things, and actually remove some of the army words and kind of make it almost in a way agnostic, military agnostic, and communicate still some of the baseline ideas? And I found, yes, you can. Amazingly, yes, you can. So we have these things in army doctrine, and in military doctrine throughout all of its principles, tactics, techniques, and procedures. And we're not the only ones that have that. There's actually quite a bit of NATO doctrine out there that kind of follows the same organization, the same taxonomy of how we build things and codify them within the body of knowledge. Amazingly, I could in fact remove all references and it would still make sense to embroidery art. So when I thought about principles and principles for the Army, like I guarantee anybody has heard them who's worked with this, which is things like the principles of war, offense, directing operations towards a clearly defined and achievable goal, or you know, even the colloquialisms, things like the best defense is a good offense. That stuff, that's a military principle. Those are overarching, guiding things, fundamental rules about how to do warfare. To contrast this with embroidery art, contrasting colors on fabric, hand sewing versus machine sewing. Those are genuine principles that seem to be relatively stable. So I'm like, check mark. Principles, I can be agnostic in that one and still communicate with others. Tactics. Tactics is tough because the word tactics is fundamentally military in its nature. But if you were to just remove the definition that tactics are the employment and ordered arrangement of things, not necessarily forces, in relation to each other, holy cow, yes, attack, seize, breach, these military words could be replaced by black work, Berlin cruel work, Assisi embroidery, petit point, those sorts of things. And amazingly, they felt like, yeah, you know, it's an ordered arrangement or employment of stitches or techniques that I could use in relation to each other to get to an end picture. Techniques was almost the same way too. The techniques, these ideas for the military, that something is non-prescriptive. It's a way to perform a mission or tasks that is largely manipulatable. That also worked as well because I began to look at, well, what does it mean to do backstitching? What does it mean to do a half stitch, a quarter stitch, a French knot? These different things could be manipulated and modified much the same way that we manipulate and modify techniques in a non-prescriptive manner to perform a mission or a function or to make a beautiful picture with fiber. And then finally, the one I was most concerned about when I began to see if does this metaphor actually work or am I just blowing smoke, was procedures. For the military, when we talk about a procedure, we're talking about things that have to be performed the same way all the time. They're standardized and they're very, very detailed steps. And the reason that we do a procedure the way we do them is because what you're trying to do for a soldier is, for anybody really, is to make it in a very standardized format of execution. And it's meant to take the thinking out of something. But more importantly, when it takes the thinking out of something, it gives that individual a standard way to organize information to execute that thing faster, more efficiently, but also to make sure that we all know that the same procedure will be executed the same way, the same every time. For most of it, when we talk about procedures in the military, we're talking about medical evacuation, which has a standard format and procedure. We're talking about the call for artillery, which has a standard format and procedure as well. These things are done the same way because we've got multiple things moving on the battlefield. And also to a certain sense, it's talking about the lives, the safety of our own soldiers. So my question became then, what competes in stitching the same way, procedurally speaking? And the only thing I could really think of was, we all want to start and stop a piece in a way that makes sure that the piece will last for a long time. Procedures is the one where I will fully admit that my metaphor kind of starts to break down a little bit. But procedures, for when I talk about them with people who are lay persons to the language of military operations, procedures tend to be the thing that they focus most on because that's life or death. And I don't mean that euphemistically at all, maybe just a little bit euphemistically. It's life or death to soldiers to do procedures right, to do them right every single time. There is this other thing that we do have, which I mentioned briefly, which is symbols and also terms. It's a terrific phrase that I've always used over and over again on social media, which is words have meaning. But when we talk about doing operations and doing military operations and cross-stitch, was there commonalities in the way that we talk about symbols as stitchers and the way that military talks about symbols and terms. And surprise, surprise, yes, there is. If we just look at the baseline definition of what a term is to our term or a symbol is to the military, and we say it's the language and graphics used on operations, we can immediately remove the word operations and surprise, use the word embroidery and cross stitch. Terms and symbols are the language and graphics we use to embroider and basically put stitch to fabric. Terms for the Army are words defined by doctrinal publications. So it's basically, that is the most self-licking ice cream cone ever. It's words that we invent to perpetuate the inventing of words. Now that I say that out loud, wow, I feel like I am a self-licking ice cream cone in my job. But we do codify those words. We have a book that we use, FM 100-2.1, operational terms. And every service, I will say, it doesn't matter, Marines, Air Force, Navy, also the joint world, the entire Department of Defense, and also our NATO allies, we all have terms. We all have dictionaries that we use over and over. And they are some of the most useful tools, both to lay people and also to professional soldiers, because I'll admit it straight off the bat. There are times in which I've spent 20 years in the military. And even today, there are times in which I will hear a term and be like, I don't know what the words that people just worded at me. I'm confused by this. I will surreptitiously go ahead and kind of Google, or I will actually go back to some of the dictionaries that are available to me at the Army level, at the joint level, at the NATO level, and actually kind of surreptitiously look the term up so I don't feel silly for not knowing what I should know. We also have a book that talks about symbols and symbology. It's when I say it to lay people, this military symbols book, FM 100-02.2, it's a little yet less user-friendly to the layperson, but it's still a terrific opportunity, or it's a terrific resource to show that, hey, we have terms and we have symbols, and they have yet again remained largely the same as we've used them. By the way, off to the left-hand side of the screen, that is an image that I pulled from an old field manual from the 1970s. Those symbols are still largely the same symbols that we've seen, and that if you were to walk into the World War I Museum today and go look at some of the overlays that are there, those symbols, same symbols. Like I said, the language and the symbology of war has remained pretty stable. It's like better than Bitcoin. So when I talk to anybody, or when I talk to somebody for the first time, this is military professionals and also to lay people who are just kind of interested in understanding what doctrine is, or what military terminology could do for them. And they're not comfortable wandering through the world of military books. First thing right off the bat, you don't have to be a military service member to read service doctrine. I will say sometimes it helps a little bit, but it's not a prerequisite at all. Anybody can have access to our body of knowledge, and it should be strongly encouraged, and transparency is incredibly important. Most US Army doctrine also is widely available on the World Wide Web. If we were to say that the World Wide Web is democratized knowledge to a certain extent, it's also kind of democratized the language of war. In a way, we can share that language with anybody, and it's incredibly important for US Army professionals to share it. And then another nice thing is, like, doctrine has become increasingly accessible on devices. I routinely, as I said before, where I hear a word and I'm like, I don't know what that word means. I should know what that word means because I've been doing this for a while. My device is usually the first thing that I'll go to and quickly type it in, both on the Google side, or I'll just pull up one of the dictionaries that I know I can work with and actually search for the term and make sure that I'm using it appropriately. Or if I hear it and I question whether or not it's being used appropriately, I can kind of push back a little bit and ask if a term might be better, a word might be better. Helps me understand things better. The way that I recommend to do this, if you've never done and you've never worked with military doctrine before, is the same way that I recommend to young lieutenants and to young soldiers as they're starting their their journey into the military's body of knowledge, which is you see a term, you hear a term, you see a graphic somewhere, and you're like, I don't know what that means, but I don't want to admit it out loud because I don't want to seem silly. What you do is you actually go to one of those two books that I showed earlier, the dot one or the dot two, and cross-reference back to the field manual that talks about those things. Because oddly enough, it's we've made it almost super simple for us to be able to do that. I can even prove this to you, because at one point, I did this on Thursday, as a matter of fact, to see if it's even possible to kind of surreptitiously or to use it in a normal, natural way. So Thursday night, I did what I always do, because I have a small apartment and I have a dog and I have basically the nerdiest life ever. I literally got home, I made myself dinner, a casserole, popped it in the oven, poured myself a drink, and I found something that I thought would be mildly amusing to watch on Netflix. I will admit it. It was The Last Samurai with Tom Cruise. I'm fully willing to own up to that one. And then I sat down while I was waiting for the casserole to bake and I began stitching. And as I heard a term, or as I hear any military term in those and used in pop culture, and it caused me to raise an eyebrow, I would head over to my computer at the time, but any device will work. And I'd pull up the operational terms and see and check what the term and the definition was. And if I felt really frosty and really curious, I'd go Google the history of the term. And surprise, surprise, I was actually pleasantly surprised that The Last Samurai, for all the historical questions that existed, the words were used right. And I sat there while stitching and enjoying a nice glass of wine, and it was almost seamless. So I felt like, yeah, if I can do this and I'm somebody who feels okay with the body of knowledge, I think I'm willing to venture that it's open and available for anybody to be able to do that same sort of thing and to just use those words or to experiment and to play with words much the same way. When it comes to terms and how this kind of really looks is, really, you're gonna hear a word and breakout. So I use the example of breakout. Anybody who has ever been sucked into watching, again, I'm sure Band of Brothers over and over on HBO, or has gotten sucked into that on the History Channel, you hear a term like breakout, right? And it is something that's very, very tied to military operations. And we love to toss it around in pop military culture and also in pop military history. So what did it mean? Well, I looked it up in the dictionary and then wound up finding that there was a reference that I could look to on the Army's Doctrine website, where I was actually able to look at the definition of breakout, the formal definition of breakout. And when I went back and looked and Googled in history how that term had been used, again, like I said, I was really surprised by how stable that idea or that concept was. So, historically speaking, the words had meaning and the words remain the same with their meaning. When it comes to symbols, this is a bit more awkward. Like I said, the military symbols book that we use for the Army it can be clunky and it's big. It's really, really thick. It's a lot of information to scroll through, especially on a little phone while you're standing in a museum. The operations overlay that I'm showing on the left-hand side is one that I recently snapped a picture of while I was down in New Orleans visiting the World War II Museum. And again, when I say that, I noticed that there's always been largely similar themes and similar use of symbols throughout history. The operations overlay that you're seeing is Neptune. So I know it says top secret up at the top, but trust me, it's not anymore. It's been declassified. But once we start to see that those symbols had remained largely the same, well, it means that you can actually look at some of these symbols and say, all right, now I know what I'm looking at. Now I understand how these things work. And to a certain extent, it helps to be able to share those images with other people, sometimes who aren't necessarily familiar with what these graphics or what these symbols, what these hieroglyphics to a certain extent might mean. It's a way for anybody to be able to know and ask questions and learn without necessarily having to find somebody to explain it to them or to have what the bigger risk is, have somebody come up to you and be like, well, actually, that's what this thing means here. This symbol means it's a headquarters, and those kinds of awful, awful feelings where you feel talked down to. It democratizes and shares out that language and those images of military operations. I will say that there is one symbol that I absolutely had to share with everybody because I loved it so much. And I'll give you a brief history of why I love this symbol so much. What this is an isolated personnel recovery point. I, as an Army aviator, I feel very, very compelled to know about personnel recovery operations. But for a long time, and most Army aviators will look at this and be like, that is the martini glass. That is a good symbol. We love that symbol. But at one point, I had actually put this symbol as a young major working on a brigade plan. I put this onto an overlay because I was explaining where I wanted to be able to do personal recovery operations and a pickup point in case an aviation platform was isolated from the enemy by enemy operations, or in the event any soldier is isolated by enemy operations or operations on the battlefield. So I put it down on an overlay. And I know what this symbol means because I'm a pilot and I've been experiencing the martini glass for some time. My colonel, the brigade commander I was working for, looked at this symbol. He's like, why? Lieutenant Colonel, well, young Major Dean, why is there a martini glass on the overlay? And I was able to look at him with full pride and say, sir, that is the downed aviator pickup point. And he's like, yeah, aviators are martinis. From that point forward, though, he always referred to the isolated personal recovery point as the aviator martini glass. So if he's out there listening, sir, I will never not be able to see that image again. but it is my favorite symbol in Army doctrine. I say that without hesitation at all. Again, it's a hill I'll plant my flag on. As we've looked forward into the future of where we go to democratize the Army's knowledge, to let everybody have access to it, to encourage other people to read it as well, we've managed amazingly to step into the 21st century. So just about every branch of military service for the US military has a page where you can go find the publications. Now, some of it is hidden behind, or not hidden necessarily, but restricted behind firewalls, mostly because there is still concern out there about never letting or never showing your hand to your potential adversaries. But what I will say for the Army and for Joint Doctrine and NATO Doctrine as well, these things are out there. You as the average layperson can pull it open much the same way that you can go and download a free pattern on cross-stitch or a YouTube video about it and actually learn these things and see them and experience them. It's not restricted to you at all. In fact, it's really, really encouraged for folks to go out there and see what your soldiers are talking about, because we are your soldiers. The other portion for the military of meeting audiences, both lay audiences and professional military audiences where they are, is to use social media. My own directorate has struggled a little bit with social media and whether or not to do it. But the idea now that we are engaging with people, engaging with all audiences where they are on these platforms, it enables us to reach out to them through Facebook and through Twitter and through YouTube as well, to be able to talk about our Army language and to use it in an appropriate way and to kind of remove some of the mysticism behind the military. One of our groups or our partners down the road in Fort Leavenworth is Army University Press. They do an amazing job at making documentaries that actually have doctrinal references within them. So not only will it provide you with the history of, say, the Philippines and operations in the Philippines in a really accessible, genuinely beautiful way, but it will also provide you with some of the doctrinal references that are applicable today. So if you're genuinely curious about, well, what does it mean to do defense? You can actually go to the websites and find the books that we're referring to within those documentaries. And I'll make sure to provide the Army University Press website, which is really user-friendly and great to navigate around. Also, I will say, I have routinely at times put an AUP doctrine podcast or a documentary on in the background. and just listen to it while I've been stitching. And they are really genuinely, Army University Press is doing some great things. My little directorate that I work for recently came into the 21st century as well and started a podcast. It's called Breaking Doctrine. And what we found is that for military audiences, they enjoy hearing from the people who wrote the books. For other audiences that are not professionals within the military or are lay people or amateur military historians, what we've heard and the feedback that we've gotten from them is they genuinely enjoy understanding a peek behind the curtain. How did this, or why did we write the way that we did? And who was involved in the process of developing the body of knowledge? It really has been a terrific way for us as military professionals to share and to be the way we are openly and talk about, without euphemism, about our body of knowledge with a much wider and much broader audience. So I'm going to kind of close this out a little bit, and then we can kind of answer some questions if there are any, because I know doctrine, super boring. But if ever there was a way for me to talk about why everybody should have access to doctrine, why everybody should be able to do it, it comes back to this idea that I was talking with a professor here at the School of Advanced Military Studies in Fort Leavenworth, and she looked at me at one point when I was telling her about my experience writing and talking about doctrine. She said, well, doctrine is an artifact. Doctrine is this image at one moment in time that when we look back at other images and moments in time with the body of knowledge and books that have been written about it, you can see trends in history. Doctrine is an artifact. And that further kind of reinforced my idea that now doctrine is not just an artifact. Doctrine is a sampler. Doctrine is, and techniques and words that we use evolve and change as the Army becomes more proficient and more skilled at what it's doing. And as we engage with other military professionals, that doctrine sampler, both the personal one that we have as we read, but also more importantly, the ones that we have at our books, ultimately show an evolution, a growth at certain times towards doing armed conflict in a way that is genuinely the American way of war. The other reason why I would share military doctrine outside of a military audience is transparency. So when it comes down to it, the military, the US military, most specifically when I talk about it, in the US Army, is taxpayer funded. We are an all volunteer force that comes from the American people. To talk without euphemism, to use words and understand exactly what they mean and to communicate simply what they mean to a wider audience without gilding a lily is absolutely crucial, because we must be transparent to the citizens that we support, that we defend. And though that seems very patriotic, it's not just patriotic. It is absolutely important as a citizen to share that language appropriately and to use it appropriately when somebody else is footing the bill for how we grow, how we evolve, and how we prepare ourselves for armed conflict as a military. The nice offshoot of all of that is, you know, recently, especially this has come out in the news, that there's this misinformation out there. And the ability of transparently sharing the language that we use, the way that we do operations, of knowing that anybody, it doesn't matter who they are, can go into doctrine, into military doctrine, and read it and understand, or to ask questions, or to understand definitions, helps with this whole process of countering misinformation and its nefarious cousin, disinformation, about current military operations and the future of armed conflict. And I say current military operations with complete honesty, because I think that would have been helpful, or can be helpful, if we as military professionals talk about joint evacuation of non-combatants, what's known as NEO, which is incredibly important for us to discuss, especially in the wake of our withdrawal from Afghanistan. And also to talk about armed conflict as it applies to operations that are ongoing in the Ukraine and with Russia's invasion of the Ukraine. It helps us to be able to to talk about language and to a certain extent, especially when there's mass media out there that may be using terms or maybe using words, to know that individuals, regardless of where they are, can immediately on their phone pull up the definition of what it means to do a river crossing, and then also be able to pull up the doctrine itself about how the US military views river crossings. It takes away and it removes some of the shade from the media and how it's portraying the importance or how it's portraying certain events that are going on in the world today. It also, to a certain extent, it sheds light on this question. Like I said, doctrine and the language that we use, if it's remained mostly stable, this idea that we live in unprecedented times is kind of like, no, we actually do live in precedented times. It's okay. It's okay to admit that. Yes, technology is changing. Yes, words may evolve a little bit, or we may go through a big purge at some point of doctrine, but overwhelmingly, the principles that we talked about, these ideas or these fundamental beliefs that we've talked about, they're pretty precedented. And that's, to a certain extent, as much as nobody ever wants to go to war, I hope that never happens, it's nice to know that that's a precedented thing. All of it comes back together to encourage frank, honest, un-euphemistic talk without any sort of heroism and hero worship about how we do army operations as American soldiers. And the other nice little ancillary benefit, and I say this as somebody who is a heterosexual woman within military service, I am one of 16%, I think, of active duty women in military service, to encourage audiences who have been marginalized away from the language of war is incredibly important. And that can begin with the language of military history, the language of warfare, by offering up to new historians that you don't have to wait for somebody else to give you the words. The words exist. Please feel free to use them, and then ask us as military professionals to explain them simply and honestly to a new audience, to new military members that may be coming in, and also to new military historians. That is incredibly, for me personally, it's an incredibly important portion of what I do when I talk about sharing the body of knowledge. Thank you so much today for allowing me to talk to an amazing crew of people, both on the World War I Museum side and also to the audiences out there listening. I know this is not a traditional sort of Mrs. Wilson's Knitting Circle, but I hope I have given you pause to thought about what it means to be both a cross stitcher and to be a member of the profession of arms. If you're ever interested, there are some terrific tools out there for anybody to use. I believe firmly it's only a lot of reading if you do it, but it starts with doing the reading. So to help folks read a little bit better and to, if they want to check out some options, U.S. Army Doctrine, which is where I work, is on social media, both on Facebook and on Twitter. We do have a website as well. It's where all of our publications, to include even regulations, are hung. The Joint World and the Department of Defense has a Twitter feed as well, oddly enough. They write the joint publications that we have. There is this, really, if you're a military historian, even if you're just an amateur historian, and you want to know, like, you want to check out the history of how words evolved, there is this amazing German repository of obsolete U.S. military doctrine that a lot of us use, and we colloquially call the bits. Basically, it's a history, or it's a organized history and a file folder that anybody can have access to of all U.S. Army doctrine, and also to a certain extent some joint doctrine as well. And if you're interested in one of the Army University Press publications or any of their documentaries, which are amazing to sit and stitch to, Army University Press has a terrific online presence, and they've got an amazing website as well. And I'm always stitching at Slightly X Stitch on Instagram. Thank you so much for your time today. And I cede my time back to Mr. Taub for the guidance of questions.
Well, thank you so much, Nikki. That was amazing. I know that if we were here in person, there would be a wide array of clapping, noises, cheering, all of the above. That was an amazing presentation. If you have any questions for Nikki, please feel free to type them in the Q&A box in your Zoom chat bar. If you're on Facebook, you can type those into the chat box there, and we'll be able to ask her here in person. Now, we do have a few questions that already came in the presentation. First off, very importantly, are all the cross stitches you showed us today, are those yours?
Those are mine, yes.
Okay, very good to know. So guys, @slightlystitch on Instagram. That is an amazing series. I love the art of mixing with military and all that. I'll say there's so much that you hit on as a historian. One way that I use the service regulation, say for the British Army, the FSRs of 1908-14, or for the French Army, Colonel Grand Maison's lectures before the war, help us as historians and educators identify the culture of the militaries that were going into World War I in 1914. Do you think that the FSRs and what you guys are working on now for historians 100 years from now are going to reflect the culture of the American military?
So there is part of me that genuinely hopes so, right? Because that's really what you want, is that good Lord, what's the point of writing a book if nobody's going to read it? And then hopefully that book gets read over and over again throughout generations. I don't necessarily think FM30 operations will become the great American classic. It's not quite Steinbeck, but it does offer, our current doctrine that we have offers a unique way to approach what we kind of look like and the things that we value, especially if you're not familiar as a novice to military doctrine, our leadership doctrine. There is one publication that I would absolutely advocate for if you've never had any exposure to the United States military and what does the Army hold in value? ADP1, which is The Army, that's the title of the book. It offers really what is the Army? What do we do? What is an Army and why does the US Army exist? It's really the glossy pamphlet for so Army, go Army. Along with it is really some of the leadership doctrine that is out there. There is a book called ADP 622. It's available on the Army publication website that's right up now. But along with it is this terrific understanding of how we use and how we approach decentralized operations that are well-planned, this idea of initiative, of a commander being involved in leading their forces, of the offensive nature, of maneuver warfare, combined arms approaches, all these terms that we tend to use, and they sound so jingoistic, but they're not, because they are steeped in a rich tradition of evolving the language. And folks can argue all they want, or anybody can argue with me about, you know, is the term appropriate, or is the way that we've written about our history, or the way that we've written about our culture, is it right or accurate? I would like to think that some of the words that we've used, because they have remained so stable, they're going to offer a great look at what does the Army value right now in 100 years? It'll probably be pretty accurate. I'm fairly certain. I feel comfortable in saying that historians will be like, wow, the United States Army, the all-volunteer force of 2022, 100 years from now, they'll be like, they really valued the importance of initiative for soldiers, for somebody to understand what it means to maneuver themselves within the commander's intent. So answer the question.
Absolutely. And I'm truly hoping that 100 years from now, as we talk about the development of what Pershing was writing and before the AF deploys to France, that people are going to be back here watching this presentation, talking about all the various ways in which doctrine and communication and language intersect. Earl Talaman is wondering, how many hours or days did it take for you to make those stitches?
Oh my God, I literally had 2 years of a pandemic. You'd think I'd have the mute button down, but no, sometimes I don't. So it takes typically for me when I do the stitches, I draw my own patterns as well, and I hand draw them because I spend most of my time and my world is on computers. So on occasion, I would prefer to not have a digital interface. So I'll hand draw a lot of my stitches. That usually takes about maybe 30 minutes to do, but the stitches themselves, anywhere from about an hour to 2 hours, sometimes up to 3 hours for bigger projects. What I'll usually end up doing, and I started doing this when I was a student here at the School of Advanced Military Studies. So I'd take breaks after doing a lot of research or doing heavy amounts of reading to process these big ideas, these big theories that I was reading about. And I'd use stitching as a method of kind of freeing my mind, focusing on something very simple, stabbing it 10,000 times, and then using this as an opportunity to sort of clear and organize my thoughts. And usually when it came down to it, it was a couple of days of whatever books I was focusing on for class, and boom, I'd have a finished stitch. And then I had a tendency to give them away to friends for free.
It's a good, it's, you know, waiting for a cool Pershing quote or something else, not pressuring, but we have time for one more question. And you're a regular at the Museum and Memorial, being so close to us up at Fort Leavenworth. As you go through the Museum and Memorial, is there any sort of interaction with present day themes and language, especially around the war in Ukraine, that the public may encounter in the news and that they could use the museum as a resource to sort of understand?
Any military museum is a terrific opportunity. I'd say that the World War I Museum, and the reason why I love it both as a modernist, but also as a patron and a military member, is you do see certain themes. The one that I absolutely see over and over again is the evolution of field artillery doctrine and the evolution of field artillery terms, more so than maneuver warfare, more so than tanks, though everybody loves the Renault tank, but looking at how the evolution of how we talk about artillery, because it was so influential to the combined arms fight of World War I. And it's also become this thing that when you look at how artillery gets employed and how we're talking about it in Ukraine right now, because artillery has always been a thing that our adversaries tend to focus on a little bit. And it should be disconcerting. It should be overwhelming to see the idea of what is a barrage? How does that get talked about in World War I? And then ultimately, what does it mean to mass fires as we're seeing it today on the news? And it feels jarring, and the language of those things remains the same. So I would say if you ever get a chance to come to the World War I Museum and just walk and look at the tanks and then look at how the tanks are described, not the tanks, it's my world has been tanks for a little bit recently. So when you look at the different artillery pieces that are there and the mortar pieces that are there and look at how they're described, how they're detailed and how they're supposed to be employed, and how they're shown to be employed on graphics, you may find whispers of consistency to what you're seeing on the news today.
Lieutenant Colonel Nikki Dean, that was outstanding. Thank you so much for joining us. I know we'll be seeing you again very soon at a modernist event at Jazz on the Lawn on June 25th. Absolutely. Folks, thank you so much for joining us today, and we hope to see you next time, the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and our next Mrs. Wilson's Knitting Circle. Have a great day, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.